lands to the north. Here, the country is still.
Job's very restless tonight.
Maybe it's a problem.
A pet dog howling at the sound of its wild cousins. A chance reaction, or maybe a legacy of a time many thousands of generations ago when it too was a wild animal. At first sight, your dog exhibits all kinds of behaviour that seem puzzling. Why does it go round in circles on the lawn or on the carpet before sleeping? Why does it roll often in animal dung? Why does it bolt its food so fast? Why do dogs like licking faces? And why do they bury bones? And what about the insatiable desire to chase and fetch sticks? The domestic dog is the most varied animal species in existence. It comes in an extraordinary range of colour, shape, and size, from 6 to 40 inches in height. From a couple of pounds to over 100 pounds in weight. But despite their vast differences in appearance, they all behave in very much the same way, a vivid reminder of their common ancestry. Conclusive evidence shows that dogs are descended from wolves, wolves that were tamed only 10,000 years ago to help man hunt and to guard his property. But the wolf is only one member of a whole family of wild dogs, living all over the world in all kinds of habitats. There's the coyote of North America. It looks like a typical dog, as do the jackals of southeastern Europe, Africa, and southern Asia. Closely related is the very rare simian fox of Ethiopia. Not a fox at all, but another kind of jackal. The long-legged maned wolf of South America, built for hunting in the long grasses of the pampas and reminiscent of the Afghan hound, bred by man for much the same purpose. The bush dog, also from South America, is small with stumpy legs designed for going under rather than through undergrowth. Our Dachshund is similar in design, selectively bred to go down holes to hunt. The Asiatic raccoon dog, highly adaptable and rapidly spreading into parts of Europe. All wild dogs tend to have large litters of young. These are dholes, Asiatic hunting dogs, with a reputation for being more ferocious even than tigers. These are African hunting dogs, dappled black, brown and white coats and large rounded ears, highly successful group hunters, but quite a distant relative of the domestic dog. In contrast, the dingo of Australia is a domesticated dog returned to the wild. In all these animals, we can find clues to the way our pet dogs behave. Some things are obvious. It's not difficult to see why your dog buries a bone. It represents surplus food, which for this wolf can be buried until another day, but buried in a very specific way. In identical fashion, this coyote fills the hole up with forward movements of the snout and packs it tight by pushing down with its nose. This English setter uses precisely the same technique. So too this dachshund. Most dogs love to play, with a compulsive urge to shake things from slippers to old toys. And the reason becomes clear as soon as we see a wild coyote pouncing on its prey and killing it by tossing it and shaking it to break its neck. Precisely the same technique demonstrated here by a silverback jackal. Your pet dog going round in circles on the carpet before lying down shares a common behaviour with the coyote in America flattening down the snow to make a nest. And the ecstasy of the dog, which loves to have his chest tickled, is a reminder of the sexual sensation of rubbing against the bitch's back during copulation. And what about that pet dog that was howling? It's often regarded as a joke.
So a warm welcome, please, to Kelly.
And as such, lampooned by TV programmes. But for the dogs, it's far from funny. The compulsive urge to howl is inherited from their ancient ancestors. In the wild, a single coyote, jackal or wolf will howl to make contact with other members of its social group. Similarly, some pet dogs will howl if tied up and deprived of company. How many puppy owners would recognise this same noise made here by a wolf cub howling for its mother? And in reply to this first howl, the other members of the pack respond. Some domestic dogs too respond to that initial stimulus. Some quality in the telephone bell sets this Dalmatian off. But tame or wild, the message is the same. We're here. Come to us. But really making sense of the way your dog behaves involves a deeper understanding of how wild dogs live. To a greater or lesser extent, all wild dogs are social, from those that live in small families to the highly structured group hunters. And one of the characteristics of these social dogs is they live in a hierarchy with a dominant leader. The pack continually explores, challenges, and reinforces the hierarchy, not by actual fighting, but by posturing and signalling, raising the hackles, for instance, to appear more frightening. The erect tail, a signal of dominance. So too the erect ears. By contrast, cringing is of paramount importance. Here the submissive wolf puts its tail between its legs and lowers its head. But these messages can be very subtle and complex. This coyote is signalling its state of conflict by its arched back, its erect hairs, its bared teeth and its tail between its legs, aggressive and fearful at the same time. Here, the dingo on the right is dominant. The submissive one on the left won't eat until permitted to do so by the top dog. As soon as he gives a little wag of his erect tail, the junior one can go in and feed. Even playtime among young dogs is a way for the puppies to determine their social status. Hunting dog puppies spend hours play fighting. Often they pick on the weaker pup and chase it until it submits. But when mature, such overt aggression is rare. Adult hunting dogs maintain their status by subtle body signals. No subtlety here. The posture of this jackal is one of total submission. And this wolf, on the back, belly exposed.
Hello, Fergus.
Hi, Lisa.
In the house, your dog uses the same techniques to confirm and maintain his allegiance to you, his pack leader. The dog which disobeys its owner is issuing a challenge. In this case, the dog has become dominant. The owner is now second in the pack hierarchy.
Come this way, Kim. Oh, go on then, that way.
In the wild, dogs groom each other as part of their social bonding. Here, the junior-ranking animal licks the senior. Pet dogs, too, will lick their owners. Sometimes, dogs will groom right inside each other's ears, removing dirt and parasites that the dominant animal cannot reach for himself. Smell is the preeminent sense of dogs, and they use it to communicate with each other. Some wild dogs, wolves and coyotes, for instance, deposit tiny quantities of urine as scent marks throughout their territory by cocking their legs. The smell acts as a warning to intruders. Similarly, pet dogs cock their legs against walls, lampposts or whatever as a way of announcing their presence. But why cock their legs at all? The object is to get the scent as high as possible so it will carry further and be protected from disturbances at ground level. But that's difficult for the short-legged bush dog, so it's evolved this extraordinary behaviour. It will push its bottom as high as it can go up the scent post before it urinates. So the dog is literally standing on its forepaws. Often dogs use their back legs to scratch after urinating. Contrary to popular belief, they're not trying to hide their scent, but to advertise it. Here, the marks in the snow draw attention to the scent signature. By contrast, African hunting dogs don't cock their legs. Living in more open country, they just urinate to empty their bladders. But if they don't cock their legs, they will roll, not out of exuberance, but to cover themselves in another strong smell. And many wild dogs do the same thing. They'll roll in anything that stinks, from feces to rotten fish. And pet dogs will do the same thing. Nothing can be more exasperating to the dog owner than to see his newly groomed hound rolling in cow dung. But why do they do it? Probably to camouflage their own scent by covering themselves in the scent of their prey. One of the reasons dogs were domesticated in the first place was for their guarding ability. In the wild, dogs will guard their pups or defend their territory against intruders. This guarding behaviour is very well developed in African hunting dogs. Some animals act as lookouts to protect the pack. And when the pups are young, one adult is left behind as a babysitter while the rest of the pack is out hunting. And when we're out hunting, our house dogs protect our homes in the same way. The Alsatian is reacting like these two jackals, attacking and driving an intruder away from their den. Now, although the intruder immediately adopts a submissive posture, the other jackals are not satisfied until it's driven off. The urge to protect its group and its home, encouraged by man, is one of the strongest links between domestic and wild dogs. Dogs will guard anything. But no dog, domestic or wild, wants to get into a serious fight if it can avoid it. Far better to make the other dog, or in this case, human, back down by intimidation.
Mama, where is it?
Growling is one means of warning, and that's just the same with wolves. Snarling, curling the lips back to expose the teeth. It's all meant to make you back down, and let's face it, it works. One behaviour pattern that man has reduced by selective breeding is the dog's urge to hunt, but it's still there in a modified form, as you'll see. African hunting dogs. At the end of a hard day's sleeping in the sun, the pack is on the point of waking up for the hunt. In an extraordinary ritual, the adults wake up, stretch, and greet each other. Within a few seconds, they work themselves up into a kind of frenzy, running from dog to dog, licking, cringing, and jousting with each other. They even urinate in their excitement. Then suddenly the greeting ceremony is over and the hunt begins. They set off at a slow walk. One animal tends to lead. Often the pack follows in Indian file to present the smallest profile to the prey. The object is, slowly but surely, to get within striking distance. You can see the same kind of frenzied excitement in pet dogs, which know they're about to be taken for a walk. And then the excitement of the walk itself, the animals straining on the leash. The hunting dogs have to maneuver themselves into a position close enough to rush in for the kill. So they walk slowly, and it isn't until the prey animals panic that the dogs shift gear. First, the dogs run at a steady canter, and then suddenly they hit top speed. The hunt is on. But it isn't so much one hunt as a series of mini hunts, with the frightened prey animals often crisscrossing in their panic. It would be wrong to say that the African hunting dogs have an organized group hunting strategy. In fact, it's no more than a straight line pursuit. In this, they differ strikingly from the wild ancestor of our domestic dogs, the wolf. Hunting in less open country, wolves employ active cooperation and division of labour. the pack circling the prey and using surprise and ambush. It's this much more complex strategy that made them the ideal species for human domestication. You only have to watch sheepdogs at work to see how easy it was for shepherds to adapt the circling behaviour of wolves and convert it into herding behaviour. Behaviour which prevents panic in the flock. The natural restraint and cooperation of the wolves is strong in these dogs. So it's simple for the shepherd, the leader of the pack, to control the hunt and suppress the final act, the kill. By contrast, the African hunting dogs show no such restraint, and it's not surprising that they were never domesticated by the human population of Africa. In the end, the wildebeest is taken. Of course, your dog doesn't kill anything when it goes for a walk, except occasionally it might. Every year, sheep are killed or maimed by pet dogs running wild in the countryside.
There was one of the farmers, not very far away at Rumney, who had 50 sheep killed in one night, 50, a total flock wiped out. But three dogs are the average run. Get three dogs together and something comes over them, a kind of a hysteria.
It's usually a terrier and usually a larger dog, either a collie or an Alsatian, that make up the pair. And the little dog usually goes for the front of a ewe and the big dog usually goes at the back of the ewe. The owners don't seem to realise that at home their pets are soft and kind and gentle. But once they get out in a country environment where the wind's blowing and out in the open fields, nature itself makes them quite different.
You can look at your own little dog in the house and think what a wonderful dog he is, but I can assure you, he's a killer when he gets in the company of other dogs.
The prey is dead, and the killers gorge. But their time is limited. The faster they eat, the more they'll get. Perhaps this gives an insight into why your dog bolts his dish of food in 20 seconds flat. Wild dogs also need to bolt food before other predators arrive to steal it. And so their stomachs become temporary larders for transporting food back to the pups, rather like gun dogs bringing back birds. Or your dog returning with a stick. The adults return with food. In a tumult of excitement, the pups run out to meet them. The greeting is a hysteria of noisy exuberance. It's a similar situation when the master of the house returns from work. The same excitement, the same strange desire for the dog to lick its owner's face. But it's not just through affection. The dog isn't so much licking the face as the mouth. And it's doing that for a very specific reason, and in a very specific way. The young pups try to get their noses and tongues inside the corner of the adult's muzzle. From species to species, from continent to continent, exactly the same gesture. In wild dogs and in pets. And the reason? The dog wants you, or in the wild, its parent, to regurgitate food. two hunting dogs squabble over the skull of a Thompson's gazelle. An action that seems strangely familiar to any dog owner. Finally, lazily, one hunting dog settles down to chew the last morsels of flesh off a piece of the carcass. Despite centuries of selective breeding, even the unlikeliest of pet dogs can rapidly regress to a state bordering on wildness if they're badly treated or abandoned. All over the world, stray dogs are a problem. Here, in the back streets of Chicago, packs of dogs roam. And here in Glasgow, there's a problem familiar to most British cities. Latchkey dogs are animals that are either let out or escape when their owners go to work, and during the day come together in loosely formed packs. The groups often form around a bitch in heat. The dogs are more of a nuisance than a menace, and all return to their owners before dark. But here, in Italy, there's another dimension to the problem. These are not stray, but feral dogs. Pets gone wild. They have no homes to return to. Nobody feeds them. To survive, they must either scavenge or kill to eat. They are dogs betrayed by man. We have domesticated the dog, and we have a duty to it, a solemn contract of mutual loyalty. If we treat it badly, we can't blame the dog if it is forced to revert to a wild hunting survival. Properly fed and cared for, the modern pet dog is the ideal animal companion for man. Its urge to hunt and kill easily controlled because of its wolf ancestry, an ancestry, contrary to popular belief, that is full of social restraints and inhibitions. And the ultimate example of the domesticated dog gone wild, the dingo of Australia. Thousands of years ago, Aboriginal man brought the dingo with him as a primitive domestic dog. Populations established themselves in the wild, where they preyed off the native marsupials. The dingo proved to be the survivor par excellence. It could live in the driest, the most inhospitable of regions. Here in Australia, as in every continent of the world, the same patterns of behaviour are to be found, from marking of territories to the driving away of intruders. When Europeans arrived, they tried to exterminate the dingo. The most ingenious of campaigns, shooting, fencing, trapping, even dropping millions of strychnine pellets from the air, all failed. And this is not a distant relative of your dog. The dingo is the same species. Man's best friend, bred by him to herd and to hunt, to guard and to guide, to retrieve and to rescue, to guide the blind and track the criminal, to be a companion or merely to look good. But for all man's manipulation, the wild dog's instincts lie only just beneath the surface. And it's that latent wildness that makes our dog's behaviour so very fascinating and makes the company of a friendly, active dog one of the lasting pleasures of human existence. So there he is, man's best friend, the wolf.